Hey guys, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda and I'm joined by Eastern Regional 250 Supercross champion Colt Nichols. How does that sound, dude?
That sounds pretty incredible. This is the constant reminder. I put it right in my living room. sitting in my dining room
table. I'd put it in the living room on a table and have some lights up on it.
Yeah, no, it's honestly cool, man. I joined some Oklahoma Legends and Trey and Justin with getting the East Coast title, so that part's pretty damn cool. I want to go back and do what
they... Justin's one of your homies, right?
I know, and he was pumped, man. He called me after the race, and we got to chat for a little bit, and he was pretty excited for me. And to be on that list of champions is pretty damn cool, man. It's a cool feeling. Maybe it quite hadn't hit me yet, but the focus is already... transitioned outdoors, so we're gonna try to do
right. You don't have time to really think and reflect.
No, not really.
Maybe after last outdoor.
After last outdoor. Who knows? We'll see where the summer takes us. But I'm pretty focused on trying to go put a stamp on this year and do good in the summer and go try to get another title there.
Yeah. All right. So, I mean, dude, you won the Supercross championship. If you think about it, like every year, well, you gained attention on the Rock River bike and everything, but. Every season has been marred by an injury of some sort, right?
Yeah.
And you made it through this year. Or you know, you guys are so secretive. Did you have any injuries that you hid this year?
I actually did, yeah. It was kind of funny because my mechanic, Matt, was telling me right after the race. He was like, man, good thing we didn't switch coasts because a weekend before we were supposed to leave, I still hadn't even booked my flight for Houston. And I went to our guy, Brad, who's our crew chief on the team. And I was just like, yo, like my knee is killing me. My wrist is still bothering me. I was like, I want to switch coast. Like I felt horrible. I couldn't even ride. And he was just like, well, better suck it up. You know, too bad we're not switching you. And you know, Jeremy and Justin are going there and that's just the way it was going to be. They had injuries they were coming in with too. So it made sense for me to go there. And I showed up to Houston and I tried to do press. I rode like a handful of laps and I just pulled off and I didn't really ride any more press. So I was nervous going into Houston 1 and it went, I thought, about as good as it could with the circumstances. And then
Houston 1, did you come from way back?
Yeah, I got a not great start. I wasn't way back, but definitely wasn't that great of a start. Worked my way up into third. And I honestly felt like I rode really well that night. Mm-hmm. And then going into Houston 2, I felt better. I think just time off the bike was what I needed. Obviously we weren't riding at all during that residency. And by the third one, I was coming around. You know, my knee had gotten better, but, you know, I think before... the first 7 races, I think I was still having to go to the Alpine Star Rig before every night show.
Shot?
Yeah, just to try to kind of get me through it. So I was kind of dealing with that the whole first part of the season. So going into Salt Lake, I was actually pumped because I was like, man, I'm not getting taped up everywhere and having to get a shot. And I was like, I actually feel good, you know. So that was reassuring for me just because I knew what I'd been dealing with all season.
Yeah. Man, but again, it was an injury that you were able to ride through and sustain your speed and all that. It's kind of, does it make you wonder, like, what if I didn't get hurt last year?
Of course it does, but we try not to look in the past. I mean, we're focused forward, and I knew if I ever had a good, healthy off season and mentally I was where I needed to be, that I could do exactly what I did. And it's one thing to know it, but then to go do it, you know, it's like, wow, it was just a weight lifted off my shoulders. And I was like, man, that felt pretty damn good to get it done. And I had just, my dad was pumped. I had my whole family at Salt Lake and got a little emotional after, but it was just such a cool feeling. Something I've wanted to do for so long, and being a little older, like I'd kind of been through some things. So maybe if that happened when I was younger, I wouldn't appreciate it as much. But now that I'm a little older and I've been through so much, it was just really gratifying. And I was just like, wow, you know, it kind of hit me all at once. So, man, it was pretty damn cool. And honestly, pretty cool to look at this thing every day.
Heck
so,
yeah.
Yeah, East Coast champ, it feels great. But now we, like I said, not much time to celebrate. Now we focused outdoors.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you mentioned the hard times or whatever you did. Mm-hmm. Your Colt Nichols FMF shirt there says struggle what, right? Mm-hmm. So is it all the injuries that you're referring to with the struggles?
Yeah, really, it was, this is a little bit of a, I'm gonna come clean a little bit, but the struggle what made us thing was a guy named Chaz French. He's a rapper, and he would always say this, and me and Justin were so into him at the time. He just spoke like truth, we thought, you know. So we just took this little saying and kind of went with it for a while, and I just felt like it was just me. I was like, wow, you know, like this is literally what has made me who I am. All those struggles, all the tough times. And after the race, it's kind of funny, I was, you know, got a little emotional with my mom when I hugged her, just because, you know, my mom and dad have been through it all. And then you know, I kind of get it together. I'm like, God, quit being a bitch. And I'm wiping my face. And then I'm like, I got to stop. And then I see Ashley Raynard. And as soon as I saw her, I lost it again. You know, just because, like, I was there so many years at Robbie's and just trying to get a ride, dude. I would just pace around his track all day on the phone with anybody I could call, trying to get an opportunity. But I hadn't really done much yet, you know, so no one really gave me that shot. And, yeah, it just kind of hit me when that happened. But yeah, this line we did with FMF was super cool. Like, I'm so pumped with how it turned out. Alex and Donnie from FMF are such good dudes, and been a big part in trying to help me kind of build a brand a little bit. And these shirts were sick. So
yeah.
I'm really, really pumped with how it turned out.
Cool. All right, so you win the title. What was the mood going into the race? I mean, it was realistically, it was pretty easy. You only had to finish, what, 20th or something in Joe 1?
Yeah.
I'm sure, being a great sportsman and competitor like you hated to see Christian go out that way.
Yeah.
But it took pressure off.
Mm-hmm.
But was there any nerves going into it? Like, anything could happen, right? Like,
yeah, I mean, honestly, you just... It's dirt bike race. You never know. I mean, your chain could break. I mean, you know, God forbid, anything. So after Christian went out, it was crazy just because my main competitor, I was almost just like, wow. You know, like, I cannot believe that happened. Like, I was very bummed for him just because he was right there, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'd been in that spot where you get injured and you feel like everything's kind of clicking, and that's dirt bikes. It just reaches up and kicks in the ass when you least expect it. So first and foremost, I was sad for him. I really was. And then after that, I was just like, wow, you know, like, this is realistic, you know, like, I could actually do this tonight. And so I didn't really handle that first Salt Lake that well. And I let it get to me a little bit. And, you know, we started celebrating before we ever even got it done. And I was just upset with how that race turned out. I feel like I just rode horrible. And I didn't put myself where I needed to be. And mentally, I wasn't quite where I needed to be when we took off. So going into the last one, I knew anything could happen, but it would be something pretty catastrophic to happen in order for you know, me to lose. So I just went in being like, man, I want to go in the race. I want to put a stamp on this thing, you know, prove that I'm the best guy this year. I wanted to leave the 250 class with the most wins, and now I'm tied with Jet and Justin, which sucked. But yeah, I mean, Jet was riding a good race, and you know, I felt like I was riding really well. But to end it the way I did, the mindset was strictly just, it's another day, you know. You're only as good as your last race in this sport. And, you know, I know, just, I'm really good friends with Coop, and hearing him talk about certain things and, you know, how he handles stuff and stuff honestly kind of helped me a little bit too. And I wanted to go handle business. I wanted to go try to win that race. And if I didn't, at least be on the podium. I'd been on the podium 9 out of 9 races this year, so that was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm.
And strictly just trying to handle business, man. We traded like any other day. And honestly, I was horrible all day. Like, practice, I was not very good. Heat race was... not that great, but the main event, we showed up and did what we had to do.
Yeah, it's funny because, yeah, you're a little off.
Yeah,
practicing time. Things, and then you come out and you're leading. I'm like, oh, he's going for it. Because isn't it funny how, like, the East-West shootout, typically one of the champions doesn't win because they're just taking care of business, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But I wanted to ask you, press day before Salt Lake City won, you had a pretty good get-off, right, in that rhythm section?
Yeah, I actually escaped it pretty easy. Like, I think it looked worse than what it was. It was the same exact jump that got Christian.
Yeah.
So we went on, off, and that pocket was super tight. And that big three where it was just a really tall face, tall landing. And I was seat bouncing it the whole time just because I felt like I needed that oomph to get over it. And then I hit it standing one time and I thought I was going to be fine. It just came up a little too short and I literally just stuck and then rolled over and kind of, you know, had fallen over and kind of endoed. But I got back up and just kept riding. I was just like, Jesus, that was...
Because, see, that happened. I was like, oh, no.
Yeah, yeah.
Colt's down.
Yeah, my clutch was all bent out. I was like, geez.
Yeah, and then, you know, the next day's race didn't go that fantastic for you. So I'm like, oh, man, I wonder if he's nursing something, you know?
Yeah, no, I was actually fine. Like, didn't have any injury or anything. But that next day, I was just... I was a mess. Like, I just couldn't quite gel with the track at all. I mean, I struggled all day with that first track for some reason. I just don't know what it was. And then... it was kind of going that way for the second one. And then by the time we got to the night show, the track was completely different from the day. It dried out so much and it was just a lot different. And I was able to kind of get it together in the heat race. I'm like, okay, like, I feel like I can win this thing still. So put myself in a good spot and did what we had to do. But yeah, that it was a little embarrassing press day crash, that first one. But yeah, we bounced back all right and we were able to handle business.
Cool. Hey, Colt, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more with Colt Nichols. Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing. I'm here with Colt Nichols today. Hey, one thing I wanted to ask you about. I don't know what you guys call it, but I miss the Instagram posts you and Bogle did walking into the pits, like with your outfits.
Oh yeah, the fit pics.
Fit pics.
Yeah,
that's what
yeah,
it was.
The fit pics. Yeah, I'm a huge basketball guy, so I see that all the time, and I actually notice the teams post it now. And those dudes are got a lot of money, and they're super into fashion and all that kind of stuff, and that correlated right with what me and Justin liked. And before Anaheim won 2019, I think it was like maybe the night before the race or two nights before, because he was staying at my house, I'm like, dude, we should just do like walk-in picks like the NBA dudes do and just see what happens. I was like, I got all this cool clothes that I buy and I have nowhere to wear it. So I'm like, we might as well put it to use and wear it. Yeah. And he thought it was awesome. And yeah, we did it that whole year. Me and Justin and our buddy Brad Frace was behind the camera for all of it. And that was fun, man. It was kind of cool just before the race. I'm like, what are you wearing, you know? And he's telling me his little outfit and stuff. Like it was, we kind of bounced back ideas. And it was cool, man. We're into that kind of stuff. And I enjoyed it. I missed it this year for sure, because Justin didn't race quite a bit. And Brad, he wasn't at the races. So I do miss that. We're going to have to bring it back next year for sure.
Definitely back. I miss seeing Frace around at the races.
I know. He hadn't been around. He's a working man in Texas nowadays. So he's getting really good at the video work. And seems like he's starting to take off and be pretty successful with it. So I'm pumped for him. He's got some stable income. And I think that's what he needed. So good dude, though. I miss having him around for sure.
Absolutely. Hey, okay, so I've asked you this a few times, and you've always given me the same answer, but like, it was tough, I'm sure, battling for the title with your teammate, right? Mm-hmm. You guys are with each other, because you both train with Swanee, so every training session, every testing, practice session, and then in the semi together, and like, was that kind of ever unpleasant, or was there friction, or?
I wouldn't say friction, no, just because, I mean, I can't speak for Christian, but for me, like, I have a lot of respect for the guy, and I wanted to race him clean and race him hard like I did all year. And there at the end, you know, maybe a week or two leading into Salt Lake, it was starting to get to a point where I kind of wanted to do my own thing. And he needed for us to ride together and all that stuff, because I think it was good for him, just because he would wax me every day. So it's kind of hard, like, for me, I'm like, I kind of want to go off on my own and do my own thing a little bit, just because I'm tired of getting my ass kicked every day. But he is so good. You know, he's such a good rider. He does everything right, form-wise and everything. And that takes a knock eventually when you do it every day. And you just constantly are getting beat by the same guy. Mm-hmm. And so for me to show up on the weekends, I was just like, I got to refocus, forget about what happens during the week, and try to go make this thing happen. So that was kind of the mindset. But at the end, I wouldn't say there was real friction or anything. I just knew that, I mean, it was only going to be one of us, you know. So by the time we went into Salt Lake, we had handled our business, done the gym stuff together, and I tried to treat it just like any other, you know, week or whatever. And I felt like at the beginning of the season, I was able to get a little bit of an edge on him at some point. And I just was going to try to do the same thing. You know, I didn't know how I was going to do it, but just try to do the same thing. So it was really unfortunate that he got hurt, though. I hate to see someone go out in that way. It was that's horrible. Been there, done that. But I felt bad for him. Yeah. For sure.
Are you guys friends? Like, get along okay?
Yeah, I mean, we get along perfectly fine. You know, like, it was never an issue with getting along. Like I said, he's a really good dude. I got a lot of respect for him. And we're both a little older. Like, I just turned 27. He's 29. And I think that helped. You know, we weren't a little immature about stuff. Yeah. And we were able to kind of understand it. And we knew one of us was going to win. And we were going to do whatever it takes, just like we had all season. But we were mature enough, I think, to handle it pretty professional and grown up. So, but we are friends. Like, I would consider him a friend. And now maybe we'll get to go play some golf together, or do whatever, you know, at this point. But before we certainly weren't, just because. Yeah. But maybe we can now.
I wonder for like a guy like Swanee, right?
Yeah.
He's like, he's training you guys. Mm-hmm. But he's also giving you race day advice, right?
Yep.
And I'm sure he's offering you some mental coaching a little bit, you know, like that kind of stuff.
I mean,
how hard is it for him to have to like, you're the best.
Yeah.
You can take this. Yeah. And then go to Christian, you're the best.
Yeah.
You got this.
Yeah, I mean, during the season, honestly, he was pretty, he was pretty straightforward. He's not afraid to kind of tell you what he's thinking or how he feels. So for me, it was good. I mean, I felt like I handled things well, and very rarely, you know, would he come back and just have nothing to say, you know, just because Christian's so good that he makes it look pretty easy. You know, at times I struggle with a few things, and I was able to push through it and get through it. But yeah, I mean, for him, he was shit, he's probably pumped. He had two guys that were, I mean, probably for sure going to win. So he's like, cha-ching, but he was probably pumped no matter what. But no, I mean, for him, I'm sure it was a difficult position to be in, but I think we both needed different things too. You know, like what Swanee will tell me, you know, Christian probably doesn't need to hear that and vice versa. So I think it worked out just fine as far as like how he was able to handle it and manage both of us at the same time going for the same thing. So I think that made it a little easier for him.
How is team manager, it's so weird to say that, team manager Will Hahn? Is he an asset like for advice and guidance? I mean, does he walk into the semi and go, when I won my 250 Supercross Championship, I did this?
Yeah, I mean, not so much in that way, like you know, when I did it kind of thing, just because he knows times have changed and things are different. But I really looked at Will for advice just because he's a team manager, but Will's a really good friend of mine, you know, on a personal level. So for me, that was my go-to guy, you know, and he's so fun to be around that I am a type of guy, I don't want things to be super serious. Like, I very funny. I mean, we're talking like idiots all day, you know, at the track, and I enjoy that. You know, I feel like it takes the pressure off. I can have somebody there to kind of bounce back and forth with, and we have fun, a lot of good banter, and he was very valuable in a sense of that. And even on the bike, I would go to him for pretty much everything, you know, like, hey, where do I look horrible, or am I struggling with this or whatever. And him and Swanee were able to work together in that way for me, and it worked really, really well. So Will's huge, man. I'm really pumped that he's around, and like having him in my corner.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure after you won that title, you got a big handful of ass.
Yeah, right? he did, of course. Will's a perv. He's trying to grab my ass all day. But yeah, it was, dude, he was pumped. To be able to see him, and you know, obviously he's been there, done that for sure. But I don't know, just kind of put everything together and put it in perspective of where I came from. And he's obviously been with Star for a little bit. Yeah. And he's seen my ups and downs. So it was pretty cool to share that moment with him for sure. Cool.
Hey, we're going to take one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for one last segment with Colt Nichols.
Together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet, designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios, globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated, and it looks good.
It's hard to put our adventures on hold, but now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products, and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing. Here with Colt Nichols, who's fresh off his Supercross title. How cool was it to have Justin Cooper win on the same night?
Yeah, that was, for the team, that was huge. Like, I mean, going into the main event, everyone's like just so pumped. I mean, the idea that they're going to win two titles in the same year, and they had never done that before. And, I've known Justin since 2017. Whenever he first came to North Carolina, and he wasn't even signed with Star yet, but he was mm-hmm. that was his tryout, I guess. Yeah. When we were staying at Cooper Webb's place, and he's a good dude. I mean, I've been around him for a while now. We've kind of shared the ups and downs a little bit, and to have him win and myself win, like, we both came off the track and we're just ecstatic. Like, we have a 1W and a 1E. You know, like, couldn't have drawn that up any better for the team. So, big moment for everybody mm-hmm. for sure.
Okay, so you have a pretty distinctive personality mm-hmm. that fans gravitate to. I think Jay Coop, he needs to come out of his shell a little bit. He's kind of a quiet guy, don't you?
Yeah.
He's funny when you know him, but.
Yeah, I mean, he is. I've had people ask me that before. Like, he's, they ask me, like, hey, how is Jay Coop? And I'm like, dude, honestly, he's awesome. He just is very selective, I think, with
and
the people he opens
dry,
up
with.
Yeah, know, I mean, just a dry sense of humor, too. But he's honestly a good dude. Like, he really is. And I'm around him all the time, and we can laugh and joke and be idiots together. So, good dude. He just doesn't show that side as much, where I'm kind of like an open book. I'm kind of an idiot most of the time, and mm-hmm. people kind of know it. So, just a little more open with my idiocracy, I guess. But no, he's a good dude for sure.
Yeah, cool. All right, so we are directing our attention to the Outdoor Nationals.
Yep.
Last year, you were consistently near the front.
No, missed it all. 19.
2 years ago. Two years ago. 19. Okay, yeah, 2 years ago. But it seemed like Cooper and then you're always near the front.
Yeah.
What is it going to take for you to be at the top?
I think now it's taking this, I think, wave of confidence I have from Supercross mm-hmm. and Outdoors, and just knowing that I'm at a point now where I know I can win. Whereas before, mm-hmm. 2019 was my, I'd raced a few races, I think, in 18, but I missed all of 2017. I only had my Cycle Trader year doing Outdoors, and I was still honestly pretty fresh into Outdoors. Mm-hmm. So. For me in 19, I was Mr. Fourth Place. I felt like I got fourth place so many times, I was pissed. But I was actually riding really well, and I felt like I was going fast and had potential to be a podium guy quite a bit. It just didn't quite work out. So going into this summer, it's carrying the wave of confidence, knowing that I can win. And I feel like my fitness is kind of on another level than what it was then. So mm-hmm. I think that's definitely going to help push me to the front. But same thing I did in Supercross, though. I felt like I was good at putting myself in good spots. I got good starts and used my fitness to my advantage. I was able to pass a lot of guys at the end of the mains this year, and I'm hoping I can do that in the summer, too. That'll be the idea. I hopefully get a good start and I don't have to worry about it. But I feel like I'm ready to win, and we'll go try to do that this summer.
Yeah. Would you say Supercross comes easier for you?
In a sense, yeah. That's what everyone tells me. But I like to think that I'm, good at both and I can do it. I think just I have struggled with Outdoors as far as consistency of being there time and time again, mm-hmm. whereas Supercross, it was a little easier for me to be consistent. So looking to change that this summer and hopefully prove some people wrong for sure.
Yeah. You've got a few days of, you probably have a lot of outdoor testing, right? Because there's a gap.
The break, yeah.
How much, obviously suspension, but like how much different is the bike from Supercross?
It's honestly quite a bit. I mean, for what we do, it's a lot. Yeah, I mean, motor-wise, gearing is a big one, even the way we run our ignition and suspension, obviously just completely different. You're changing races and clamps, and I'm still trying to figure some things out as far as how I can just get a little more comfortable, but mm-hmm. for the most part, we have a really, really good base setting, and we did all that during the break. I mean, I did... Yeah. I want to say already through a full season of motos just in that break. So we've put in the work, I put in the time, and now it's just about getting a touch more comfortable, and then we can go to the first race and feel really confident in what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. All right, during that break, mm-hmm. spend some time with you guys at the track, like Fox Raceway. Mm-hmm. How does Swanee determine the order of you guys taking off? Because it's always like staggered, right?
Yeah, it's a little different.
Does he go off lap times early in the morning, or is it just he just mixes it up?
Every now and then he'll mix it up if we don't do a super pole lap. But like today at Glen Helen, we did a super pole lap at the end of our warm up. So we do like a 15 minute warm up. We did one heater, and then that's how he determines the order. And today I was dead last. So I started last in the first moto. And
well, sorry, if you're dead last, are you the fastest guy and you're supposed to pass everyone?
No, slowest.
He starts you in order of who's the fastest.
Yeah, fastest and slowest. Every now and then, depending on the track, he'll swap it. Okay. So like if we're at Fox, every now and then he'll put, you know, slowest to fastest, and we got to go try to catch him. But today I was a little off on the super pole lap. So I started last and had to work my way through a few guys. But yeah, that's usually how he does it.
Same for Supercross?
Supercross, yeah, about the same. Like, if we go to a public track and there's a little more lines, you can open things up, he'll go slowest to fastest, and we got to try to pass. But at Yamaha, it's honestly kind of hard. Like, there's one, it's like a goat trail. So, one rut around the whole track. So, we usually go fastest to slowest just so no one's, like, not killing each other. But, yeah, that's usually how he does it. It's actually pretty smart. He's got that down now. He's been doing that for a long time. So, he's got the program dialed for us.
Okay, so then the one day I saw where Malcolm's in the very back, that means he was the slowest guy.
Yeah, maybe right? So, yeah. Oh, okay. I don't know that
name.
So
I'll know from now on, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, every now and then, yeah, he'll swap it. But today it was fastest to slowest for sure.
Okay, so the Star Racing Yamaha team is massive, right? Like, you guys look like a football team.
Yeah.
Is it advantageous to have that many riders on it, so you always have somebody to push you? Or is it sometimes like, hey, what about me? I need some attention too.
Yeah, I think both. I mean, for me, it was good because, especially Supercross, just because I constantly had somebody to chase. I mean, Christian is so good during the week. Malcolm, so good. I mean, and they're really good at what they do too. Like, they have certain things that they're just really good at. So for me, I'm just trying to learn. So I'm picking it up and trying to get a little better. And that was really good for me. And you constantly do have someone to push. But then at times I'm just like, dude, there is so many, I just want a day where I just ride by myself. I don't have someone up my ass 24/7. So it's got its, you know, plus and minus, of course, but they've, whatever they're doing is working, man. They got some young rookies that are doing really, really well, very successful program. And I'm just pumped to be a part of it, honestly.
Yeah. Okay. Well, looking forward to seeing you race this summer.
Let's go.
See you get those firsts, right?
That's the idea.
Yeah. Congrats again on that title. It's been awesome watching it unfold. And thanks for coming on the show again.
Of course. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it, as always.
Guys, thanks for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.